Hi everyone, my name is Vaibhav and today I'll be giving an introduction to a library called JAX. It is an open source library. So JAX is a Python library for high performance numerical computing. So you must have heard of libraries such as NumPy or TensorFlow, etc. So JAX provides certain functionalities that can be useful if you are doing some sort of statistics or if you want to build neural networks, etc., etc. And some of the core features that JAX provides are the following: automatic differentiation, JIT compilation, vectorization, and parallelization. So we'll go through each of these one by one. I may not be able to cover parallelization today, but we'll at least see the first three in the list. So note that the key feature of JAX is that all of these functionalities are implemented as composable program transformations, so that it allows you to write functions as if you are writing math. So it is sort of a functional paradigm in some ways, and it is easier to read and easier to implement compared to slightly old frameworks such as TensorFlow, which may seem complicated to some developers. So let's just look at a very simple function called fn, which takes two arguments, x and y, and it is defined as x squared plus y. It returns the value x squared plus y. And if you call fn with these two parameters, one and two, then this is evaluated like any other Python function. So you would get the result 1 squared plus 2, which is 3. Now, let's look at automatic differentiation provided by JAX. So JAX provides differentiation for arbitrary numerical functions. So you can just define any Python function that you want, that is a numerical function, and you can apply difference. You can find the differential of that function. So for example, you can use the grad method provided by JAX to get the gradient of this particular method called fn. So let's call our result df underscore dx, which is basically df by dx of fn. And internally, it would compute this to be 2x. And when you call df upon dx of 1, 2, then you would get the result 2. So you can see that all we did was wrap the function fn. We just called a grad with the method fn as the parameter. And similarly, we can also find the second derivative or the third derivative, so on. So if we call grad of fn, then we get the second derivative of fn, which is df2 upon dx. And again, here you would get the differential of 2x, which was the first derivative, which would turn out to be 2. So this is a primitive provided by JAX out of the box, and you don't need to implement anything yourself. You just have to import this method and you can use it right away. Let's look at the second core feature provided by JAX, which is JIT compilation. So JIT stands for just in time. So what JAX does is that you can annotate certain methods or certain statements such that they are compiled at runtime into another intermediate representation, which is more performant than native Python code. Especially this is useful if you are wanting to run your code on GPUs or TPUs or a mesh of GPUs or TPUs. So XLA stands for Accelerated Linear Algebra, and the core objectives of XLA are to improve speed, improve memory usage, and improve portability. Assume that you want to create some neural network that runs on CPU as well as, let's say, on mobile as well as on some other devices. We want to be able to create binaries that run across multiple platforms by writing our utility only once. So all of these things are made possible by XLA. So let's come back to the function that we had previously written. So we again have our old function fn, which is defined as x squared plus 5. And this time what we do is that the second derivative that we had computed, grad of fn, we call the jit method with our initial function, which was grad of fn. So this is what we call the jitted version of grad of fn, and this is the XLA compiled function. So internally, there would be some optimizations that JAX's XLA bridge would perform, which would convert this to another intermediate representation, which would make things run faster on whatever device you are using under the hood. So the input language used by XLA is called HLOIR. So IR stands for intermediate representation, and HLO stands for high level operations. So it is similar to some compiler intermediate representation. If you know about GCC or about LLVM, they have their own intermediate representations. Similarly, HLO is part of the MLIR framework, whose goal is to provide this intermediate representation for things like vectorization or single program multiple data kind of things, or if you want to run things on the GPU. So your program is first converted to an XLA HLO set of statements, which is kind of a graph of HLO IR instructions. And then these are converted to target. So you run some optimizations that are target independent, because let's say you have some graph of computations, then there are some optimizations possible without taking care of what backend you are going to run this on. Let's say you don't know whether this will be run on a GPU or a CPU or a TPU, etc. But still, at times there will be possibilities where the compiler knows what are some optimizations I can make to make this particular function, jitted function, run faster. So that is step one. Now this generates a new program graph, which is again in the form of XLA HLO, and this is further optimized based on what backend you want to run your program on. So JAX would internally know what kind of devices are connected to your machine, whether you only have a CPU or you have multiple GPUs, etc. And it would generate a new graph which is optimized further. And the final step would be to generate code that is native to your architecture. So some of the optimization passes, as we discussed before, are so there are some operation fusions where, let's say, you have a series of operations written in native Python, which might be fused for things such as for hardware devices such as GPUs, because they might be more suitable to run vector operations or matrix operations, etc. And the HLOIR can cater to those kind of operations. The second thing can be buffer analysis, where, let's say, you want to load some data onto a GPU or a TPU from the CPU and vice versa. So HLOIR can handle things related to buffer analysis to decide at what moment what memory needs to be loaded on the GPU and what needs to be taken back from the GPU onto the CPU, etc. So the high level flow is such that you first, after performing all of your optimization steps, you generate your HLOIR graphs, which could be for CPU or GPU or both. And then eventually you generate LLVM IR. That is what the MLIR depends upon. And from the LLVM IR, we generate native code. So that is the final step in our process. But you don't need to think about all of this. So all you need to do is that you just need to call the JIT function that JAX provides, and everything else is handled by JAX under the hood. So you don't need to think about what is my function or what are my devices connected and so on. You just need to use JIT, and JAX would do the rest of the things. And the result would be a highly optimized code that could potentially run on multiple GPUs and TPUs. Let's look at the third thing, which is vectorization, which might be useful for single instruction, multiple data kind of programming. Again, let's come back to our previous function, but let's assume that you have a batch of inputs instead of just one input. So right now, let's say that we are saying we are just creating an array of ones and our batch size is two. So we have two inputs. So in traditional Python, you could potentially create a list comprehension or so on, where you would call fn for each set of inputs in your batch. However, with the help of JAX, you can use the vmap utility, where you can say that this is my jitted function, which is grad of fn, and I'll just call vmap on it, where it will automatically feed each of the inputs to the desired method and yield the results back. So let's say that you have two GPUs and your batch size is two, and your total number of inputs are 2x2, then vmap could internally create an integration such that it is optimized to run the same method across all of these inputs. And it is much faster than creating a list comprehension or any of the native Python stuff. So why should we use JAX? It is a very simple to use API. It has very few abstractions, but all of these are very powerful because these are very native. These are very fundamental operations that are useful to create things such as neural nets, for example. So even if you want to create very, very complex neural nets, all of these fundamentals usually suffice to create neural nets that run at scale, even if you have very, very large inputs that you want to split across multiple GPUs. And the most important part, at least for me, is that I can write code that looks like math, which is very easily readable by folks in my team and so on. So recently there was some breakthrough in the MLPerf benchmark competition. And so it is basically a competition where a particular set of models are trained and you also run inferences on those models. And as you can see in the picture, we have a large mesh of TPUs on which we do the training of these models. And folks at Google did use JAX to train several different kinds of models on TPUs, which were highly performant. And they basically showed that you can train all of these models very, very quickly in a few seconds on a very large mesh. So this is basically kind of a supercomputer that is training an ML model at a very fast pace. So JAX was kind of instrumental in breaking this record. So yeah, it has been kind of battle tested and it is being used in production. So even though it is a relatively new library, it is pretty mature for production use cases. So let's quickly go through a case study. So the picture that you see on the screen is a Go board. So recently DeepMind came up with a model called AlphaZero. And before that they came up with AlphaGo, which was basically a neural net to solve the game of Go. And there's a documentary on YouTube you can watch called AlphaGo. And those models, the challenge that DeepMind was trying to solve was that they wanted to beat the top human Go player with the help of a computer. So this was kind of the historical progression of the models. We started off with AlphaGo, where you knew that we are going to only model one game, which is Go, and we are going to gain knowledge from human data that is previously played Go games. We are going to have some domain knowledge, for example, what are the best moves in a particular state of the game, etc. And you also know the rules of the game beforehand. Next came AlphaGo Zero, where you didn't have any prior information about human games that were played in the past, and you didn't have any domain knowledge either, but you still know the rules of the game. And after that came AlphaZero, where they generalized it for three different games, Go, Chess, and Shogi, But here again, you only know the rules of all of these games. Now, after that, the final model was Mu Zero, where they wanted to generalize it for a larger number of games, including Atari, where you have these graphical games, and you don't even know the rules of the game. So you have to, the model has to learn everything from scratch. So this is a considerably complex use case because it involves reinforcement learning. It involves multiple different networks. It also involves an exhaustive search of sorts and so on. And folks at DeepMind have implemented this model in JAX from scratch. So yeah, as we saw on the previous slide, Mu Zero is a generalized model to solve all of these games, chess, shogi, go, and Atari. And in the charts that you see below, you can see the ELO rating of the bot as the number of training steps increase. So for X number of training steps, what is the ELO rating achieved by the bot? That is what the chart basically says, except for Atari, where the result is the reward. So that is also a scalar value. So kind of the one of the core ingredients of Mu Zero is something called MCTS, which is Monte Carlo tree search, where you consider the tree of all possibilities of moves that you can play from a particular state. And it involves exploring nodes based on some heuristics, which involves a policy network, a value network, and some reward. So the reward, so basically when you are at a particular node, based on all of these three values, the policy, the action value, and the exploration bonus, you decide whether you want to expand a particular node or you don't want to expand a particular node. And you keep doing this until you reach the end state of a particular game. As soon as you reach there, you determine how good or bad that particular state of the game is. So after you reach the end of the game, you backpropagate the value, the final value state of that game to the ancestor nodes and so on. So you keep simulating this process until for a particular finite amount of time, until you come up with the best solution from a given state of the game. So this is a neurally guided MCTS. The challenge here is that implementing this in Python can be a bit slow because this is essentially a sequential algorithm. And there can be several bottlenecks given that the CPython interpreter inherently is kind of slow compared to, let's say, a C++ binary and so on. So there is some scope for improvement here where you can implement all of these using JAX so that some of these operations can be run on GPUs or TPUs. You can optimize the data transfer processes, etc. So yeah, one of the key advantages that the DeepMind team got was that the number of times you transferred a particular state of the tree from the CPU to the GPU or vice versa was reduced quite a lot. And if you wanted to run several batches of data, if you wanted to run MCTS for several batches of data in parallel, then you could use VMAP. And all you needed to do was write your MCTS functionality only once or your search functionality only once. And JAX would take care of the rest of the stuff. You don't need to handle batching separately. Another thing is parallelization. So let's say you want to run training for your models on multiple GPUs independently. Then again, you can use the PMAP functionality in JAX, which we haven't covered here. To decide what kind of training needs to be run on what GPU or TPU, etc. Okay, so coming to very concrete neural network cases from the primitive JAX operations, this is a library called Flax, which provides you neural network layers basically. Using which you can create traditional deep nets, etc. So for example, Flax provides a module called Linen, which contains several layers such as a dense layer, a convolutional layer, an attention layer, LSTM, etc. And it also provides optimizers such as SGD momentum adder and so on. So this is kind of like Keras, if you have used Keras in the past, where you have all of these layers provided out of the box, and you just need to stack them up as you want. So this too internally is implemented in JAX. So it uses all of the JAX primitives internally, which you don't need to look into. And you can just stack up all of these layers as you want them to model your neural net. So for example, you can look at this very simple implementation of a multilayer perceptron, where let's say that you have some k dense layers, and each of those has a ReLU activation applied to it, except the large dense layer. So here you can see that, let's say the ith dense layer consists of features of I number of nodes. Then this creates a dense layer with those many nodes applied to the input. And on top of that, we apply a ReLU, which is the activation function. And we keep doing it in a loop until the last layer, which is a dense layer. So on the dense layer, we can later perform some sort of, that would be a task dependent thing at the end. So this is, for example, a very simple way to implement an MLP. Next, this is a very simple autoencoder implementation, where let's say that you have some input and the target is to replicate the output, keeping some latent variables in between. So as you can see in the call method here, we take some input X, we first encode it, and later we decode it. So this would be output of your autoencoder. And yeah, here you have the encoder where let's say you take the input and you just reshape it. And in the decode method, you decode the latent variable, which is Z, and you take the sigma and then again reshape it. And the encoder and decoder both are defined as MLPs, which we defined in the previous slide. So as you can see that it is pretty straightforward to implement at least some of the basic neural network architectures. If you would have looked at, let's say, TensorFlow V1 or something, things were much more complicated back then, and would have to do all sorts of crazy things to implement even the basic of neural network architectures. But since Keras, things have changed, and JAX kind of simplifies that even further, and it provides you more control over how you want to implement things, as well as provides black boxes such as all of these layers that you can see here. So there's a reasonable amount of control here that a developer would have while implementing some neural network models. There are some more libraries in the JAX ecosystem that might be useful for folks. One of those is Giraffe. So if you want to create graph neural networks, which are getting popular these days, you can use this library, which uses JAX internally. And the next library is Optax, which is specifically a library for optimizers. So if you want to do any kind of gradient processing, you can look into Optax. And Haiku is a library which is kind of similar to Flax. So if you want to create some neural network architectures, you can look at Haiku as well. There's also a library called Trax, which I'm not written here, but Trax is also similar to Flax. So you can use whichever library that you want that seems comfortable to you. There are a lot of variety of options. I'll just quickly move on to a collab where we can see all of these functions in action. So here you can see that I've imported NumPy and I'm just creating a matrix out of it. So this is just some random 1000 cross 1000 matrix. And I can perform some random operation. Let's say I'm multiplying the entire matrix by a scalar 2. Or here I'm doing a broadcast operation where I'm computing the mean of each column and subtracting that, and so on. So all of these operations are kind of very popular among NumPy users. However, JAX provides its own implementation of NumPy-like functions, which are optimized to run on GPUs and TPUs, and they also involve jitting. So let's say that you have, let's say you import JAX.NumPy. Then you can just pass NumPy arrays to create JAX NumPy arrays. For example, here I create Y, which takes X as input, which is a standard NumPy array. And here you see a message saying that there is no GPU or TPU attached to our runtime right now. So we fall back to the CPU. And another interesting thing to note here is that the type is a device array and not a NumPy array or a JAX NumPy array, etc. Because internally JAX wants to keep an abstraction that talks about this is some array that is stored on some device, either a GPU or a TPU or a CPU, etc. So this is the type that they use to maintain these arrays. So you can notice the difference between this NumPy array and the device array. And you can do the same operations between on the JAX NumPy arrays as you could do on the standard NumPy arrays. But yes, here you can see that all of these are device arrays. Now, let's try to see what is the time difference between NumPy and JAX NumPy. So I just run a time it on this particular dot product between X and X. And here you can see that 10 loops were run with the best of 5 being 65.8 milliseconds per loop. Now the same thing, if we run it on JAX.NumPy, where we multiply Y and Y. Let's see what the results look like. Okay, so here you can see that it was able to run 100 loops and the best of 5 was almost twice as fast with 32.6 milliseconds per loop. Now let's look at the JIT compilation that we talked about earlier. So here I have some method f of x where I'm just running a loop from 0 to 9 and I'm just subtracting 0.1 into x from x itself, and then I return x. Here x was our original NumPy array as we had defined above. So we get some output here. Similarly, we can also do it for y. So our method still remains the same. We don't make any changes here, but the input passed is y. And again, here you would see that you get a device array back. Now let's run the time it operation here. And here you get 28.7 milliseconds per loop. Yeah, you can just run a time it. Yeah. So here you can see that again, the JAX NumPy method is faster. However, we haven't jitted our method yet. So let's create a function g, which is the jitted method of f. Okay. Cool. So we initially saw that f that was not jitted took 28.7 milliseconds per loop, However, the jitted version of f, which was g, had a best of 5 of 909 microseconds per loop. So that is quite a big difference in the runtimes, which shows that jitting provides quite a lot of benefit, even though we are just using CPUs right now. So if we were using, let's say, GPUs or TPUs, more complex operations would run faster because there was just this one-time cost of transferring memory to the GPU. But after that, all operations would run on the GPU and you would get the results back on CPU. So jitting is a very helpful utility to improve performance of the operations. Let's say you want to deep dive into what this jitted function looks like internally. Then JAX provides something called make JAX PR, which is basically JAX expression. You can see what the JAX expression would look like for this particular input. That is, for g of y, what does the JAX expression look like? So this is what happens under the hood, and this is what the intermediate representation would look like, which later gets converted to native code. So yeah, this might be helpful for debugging sometimes if you want to see what the XLA output looks like. Now let's look at automatic differentiation again. Let's say you have this function f, which is x times sine of x. And I call f of 4 to get some output. So this is our output right now. And here you can see that I have manually created the first derivative of f, which is x cos x plus sin x. So let's see if we get some output here. And let's see if we get the same output using the grad method provided by JAX. So you can see that we have the correct output. However, we didn't have to implement the chain, the actual implementation of the gradient, because this could be a more complex method whose differential might be very difficult to compute. Instead, we can just use JAX's grad utility to do the same thing. Now let's say that you have another method called square, square of x, which is basically finding the sum of all squared values in your input x. So here we basically took all numbers from 0 to 9 and computed the sum of all squares, which comes out to be 285. And let's say that I create 100 elements and reshape that to a 10 cross 10 matrix. And I want to find the sum for each row. And I have a list comprehension here that computes the square for element 0 to 9, then 10 to 19, and so on. So you get this particular output here. And if we run time it on this list comprehension, let's say that it takes 4.94 milliseconds per loop. This is what we get. Now, instead, what we could do is that we could just use the vmap utility from JAX, and I create a new method called vmap square, and I get the output here, which is the same as this output. And let's run time it on the vmapped square method as well. So you can see that it is nearly 3.5 to 4 times faster than your usual list comprehension that you had implemented above. Again, here we can see what this vmapped square function would look like. If, let's say, you wanted to see what the JAX expression for the square method looked like, then you can see that you just have an integer power instruction where the power is 2 and your input is 0. And then finally, you just do a reduce sum across this particular axis. So yeah, this can be helpful to see what's happening under the hood. So yeah, I've tried to cover some of these fundamental things about JAX. You can see all of these links later to get a more deep dive idea about JAX and implementing neural nets using JAX or FLAX, and so on. You can also deep dive into XLA, and XLA actually it provides bridges for TensorFlow as well as PyTorch along with JAX. So yeah, you can sort of create these optimized compiled binaries for TensorFlow programs as well. But yeah, it has a different bridge because you have written some TensorFlow code which you want to compile into an optimized intermediate representation. So it would have a different bridge compared to the bridge that JAX has. So yeah, these are two different bridges, but you can still get an optimized XLA output for both of these. So yeah, that's it from my side.
Awesome, awesome. So let's, if you have any questions, folks, please post those on the YouTube live chat. I will also share the one which I got. So maybe you can switch to Jitsi, Vaibhav, so that you can see the questions on my screen.
Okay. I've stopped sharing my screen.
Yeah. So if you can see the screen on Jitsi, you will see. So the question was related to initial few slides where we had the differentiation of X and Y. So there were two variables, X and Y in function. Grad only, I don't know what that means, FAVE. If you can see the screen, please take a look at this question. Yes. So differentiation of F and X dx, how it ignored differentiation with respect to Y.
Okay. Yeah, so it doesn't ignore Y exactly. So internally it calculates partial derivatives with respect to both X and Y. So I'll just put a link in chat. So there is this thing called automatic differentiation that you can read up more about on Wikipedia, where you can see how computational graphs can be constructed to compute the derivative with respect to each variable. So we just took two variables in our case, but consider a neural net with a large number of parameters where each of those is a variable. So let's say that you have a million parameters. So now you have a million variables. So essentially what you would try to do is that internally you would find the Jacobian, which would basically be a matrix of partial derivatives with respect to each of the variables. Let's say you have n variables, x1, x2, x3, up till xn. Then you would compute the partial derivatives with respect to each of those and then accumulate them. So, but yeah, the best resource for that, in my opinion, is the Wikipedia page of automatic differentiation. You can see very well worked out examples there. And there are several techniques mentioned there. But specifically, you might want to read about something called reverse accumulation. So yeah, you can check that out.
Do we need to install JAX and configure it separately for CPU and GPU like we do for TensorFlow?
Okay, no, you don't need to configure it separately for CPU and GPU. So JAX figures out by itself what kind of hardware you have attached to your to the machine on which you are trying to run your program. But however, you can specify what devices you want to run your program on. But apart from that, you don't need to set anything else. Essentially, you would just need to specify the device IDs that you want to use. Let's say you want to use a mesh of TPUs, then you might have to specify exactly which device IDs you want to utilize. But let's say you are having a particular, something like a desktop machine which already has a GPU, for example, then you don't need to do anything, and JAX would figure out by itself that you have a GPU attached to your machine, and it will try to utilize it, unless you explicitly turn it on.
Awesome. Yeah, let's wait for a minute or two. If people have more questions, they will post them. So there will be a slight delay in the stream, right? So let's wait.
Sure.
Okay, yeah, I don't think there are any other questions. So I guess we can conclude. Thank you for the talk. It was very interesting to see a new library, and you covered it very well with basics and then demo and all.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And thanks for hosting this.